Joining us today is a very special guest, Senior VP of Sales at G2 Crowd, Olivier Labbé.
Thank you so much for having me. Yeah, I appreciate it.
We're very excited to have you here.
Thanks.
So, from my understanding, you have a new addition to your family that you're expecting. Tell us a little bit about some of that excitement around that.
Yeah, so our third son is on the way. My wife and I, we have a 10-year-old, a 5-year-old, and now soon to be a newborn in the next couple of weeks. We're trying to get a little girl, and yeah. We got another boy.
So, like I was saying earlier, my question is a little bit more self-serving because I'm always really interested in learning a little bit more about how people decide on the names of their kids. So I'm curious about what your process was, yours, and hopefully your wife was involved in that process as well.
Yeah, of course. That's a really good question. So my name is Olivier. So, you know, growing up, I moved to the U.S. when I was 14. We moved to Texas, and Olivia did not go well there. So I changed it to Oliver. But later, when I moved to California, I went back to Olivier. And, you know, when I travel internationally, my name was, you know, always something people are asking, like, oh, tell me more. And it was just, you know, nice icebreaker. So we gave our kids some very interesting names. And hopefully they'll like it when they grow up.
Is there a front runner for this one right now? Have you guys?
We do, yeah. So our oldest, his name is Mateo. The second one is Nikai. And the third one is Pax. It's short for Paxton.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So earlier on, before the cameras started rolling, we were talking a little bit about hockey. And you mentioned that that your kids aren't really into that. Any plans for the third son of potentially...
Yeah,
a bit more acquainted with the sport?
I don't know. We live in California, and you know, you can't just go outside in the winter and play at the rink. And that's something I used to do as a kid. Every day after school, we'd just get our gear and just go play at the ice rink, just like you play basketball here in California. And so, without being easy to do, I'm not sure that's going to happen.
Yeah. No roller hockey.
No roller hockey. No, we're basketball family, and I like golf, and I'm trying to get my kids into golf.
Yeah.
But we'll see. If there's another sport, that's the one I'd like to.
Yeah, awesome. Well, tell us a little bit more about your role over at G2 Crowd, and you know, essentially what gets you excited to wake up in the morning and get to work.
Yeah, so I'm Senior VP of Sales. So I've been there for 2.5 years. In that time, we've scaled from 5 people in sales team, around 80 people now. So now we have a lot of different sales teams. And what gets me up in the morning, I get up really early. I'm 5 a.m., you know, I'm wide awake, I'm happy, I'm like ready to go, and so...
That's very different from me.
Yeah. I love the morning, and I like to go to bed early. Like 9:30 comes around, I'm useless. So what gets me up in the morning, I'm like, you know, a couple things. One is my family. You know, I love being there for my family and my kids, and that gets me excited to get up and live a good life. Gratitude as well. When I get up in the morning, I try to sit quietly and do some meditation before the day. Gets me, you know, in a good mindset. So I think about, you know, being about gratitude. And then the last thing that really excites me is the ability to, you know, help. We have a large team now, and help young professionals, you know, to get their craft to where it needs to be, and help their customers, and that's always rewarding.
Yeah, how big's your team these days?
So yeah, like I said, there's about 80 people. So we have different teams. We have a BDR team, we have a small business team, we have a mid-market team, we have an enterprise team, and then we have an account management team, customer success, and implementation.
Yeah, it's awesome. One of the things that I remember you mentioning as part of a recent podcast that I was listening to was that curiosity was something that was really important for you when you're looking for new people to add to your team. And I'm curious about why that's really important to you, and what role does that play in building these relationships with some of the prospects that they're going to be talking to?
Yeah, so the idea was, I forget where I got it, but it wasn't my idea, it's something I picked up along the way, but basically, if somebody is curious, they're going to be more inclined to ask difficult questions when they're trying to help the customers, right? Yeah. And the difference between a good salesperson and somebody that's struggling is, you know, it starts at the beginning of the call, right? So you have to build a rapport, but then the other thing is you have to ask good questions. You know, how is the person that you're speaking to measured, right? And you know, how can you help them be more successful in their role? What is working? What's not working? And so, if the person, you know, if the salesperson is curious and always asking for more and more, they're going to get more information out of the prospect, and it's going to make it easier to, you know, establish a good relationship, understand, you know, how you can help them.
Yeah.
And then three is like when it's time to close a deal, you know, and they say, well, I don't know if I'm interested. And we're like, well, you told me these are your pains, right? well, here's how I can help you get there. Yeah. And so I think that's the important thing.
Yeah. So you and me, we live in this world where relationships are key, both on the marketing side and the sales side. And I know that one of the things that's really important to you is building that trust and that rapport through transparency with the prospects that you're speaking to and that your sales team is engaging with. But how important is it to be transparent and to help these prospects that you're speaking to really understand that you're trying to build this rapport in order to help them to be successful what they're doing?
Yeah, I think it's key. I mean, anytime if you're meeting people, you know, you want to establish a new friendship or you want to get a new prospect to engage with you, two things you mentioned, right? One's transparency. The other thing is getting them to trust you.
Yeah.
And so you have to basically, you know, be yourself, right? Don't be a robot, because people can feel that and they're just not going to want to engage with you and not trust you. So one of the things I do is I'm usually a pretty happy person, especially if I'm, you know, talking to a new prospect or customer. And then I tell them a lot about myself.
Yeah.
Right. And then they feel like they, you know, want to share that with you as well. And so they'll start talking about themselves. And that's first key to any successful relationship is, you know, the ability to trust each other and like each other. And I think it's up to the salesperson to, you know, make it easy on the client or the prospects.
Right. Right. Before the camera started rolling, you were talking about how you had some data around how when your sales reps are using their face, or at least a picture of their face as their avatars when they're having these web conferences with their prospects, that they have a higher rate of success. So
yes.
I'm curious about how you guys came to that conclusion. And you know, it's so important in terms of building that relationship to be able to see exactly what that other person looks like, right? So
yeah.
I'm curious about some of your findings and why you guys even decided to start measuring that.
Well, we use a company, can I say? So we use Zoom for video conferencing. And so we've been using it for a couple of years. And I started showing myself when I was, you know, engaging with prospects and customers. And I noticed that, you know, we're able to build a better relationship more quickly.
Yeah.
Because it's not just on the phone. The other thing is the prospect, if they're showing their camera, they're not going to be on their laptop, just like, you know, because you're looking at them, you'd be like, you're not really
listening. It's just like our team meetings.
Yeah. So that's one thing. So we're showing video when we do a call. So we do Zoom for that. And then we use another app called Cloud App, which basically gives our reps the ability to show our website and then show their face and say, look, I noticed these reviews on our site. You look great in this new report. And then showing the face, right?
Yeah.
So people are getting more familiar. And so you're able to basically build a relationship, even though, you know, you're not talking to them all the time.
Right.
And the other thing is these videos keep on selling for you, right?
Yeah.
Because, you know, when they're not there, it's going to get shared with other people.
Right.
And so feels like there's other members of the company that might know you now.
Right.
They might stop you at a trade show and say,
right,
hey, how are you? I saw a video that you sent to one of my colleagues.
Right.
And so we're really bullish on video. That's definitely something that we're doing more of.
Yeah. So a lot of the conversation that we've been having has been around some of the tactics that really helped out just in terms of top of the funnel and building those relationships. Obviously, for a company to be successful, it needs to build longer term relationships. And I'm just curious about what some of your processes are in ensuring that these relationships that you're establishing early on, that they turn into these longer relationships that continue to build and that kind of end up being really great partnerships for your team as well as these prospects and ensuring that both of you guys are successful.
Yeah, so what's interesting is there's people are not working at their jobs as long as they used to, right? So now if you are, you know, targeting an account, or if we talk about a relationship, you know, the good thing is if you establish a good relationship, then hopefully, you know, once they move on, they'll think about you, right?
Right.
You send them a note, congratulate them on your role, and hopefully, you know, you guys can do business again.
Right.
And one thing we're doing at the account level is we're going top and bottom up, right? Because there is turnover and you don't want to be single threaded.
Right.
And so we're doing now a lot of work to make sure that our executive team and our board is, you know, is helping establish relationships at the executive level. And then we have our BDRs, which are, you know, working on, you know, the managers and directors. And then we try to have our accounts executives focus on the, you know, the VPs and the directors.
Right.
And so we have a strategy to make sure that we're building a relationship across the entire organization.
Yeah. What are some of the tools that you guys are using right now to be able to manage some of those relationships?
So we are using, I mean, LinkedIn is definitely something that we use. We use Sales Navigator there, so we get updates as to, you know, when people are changing jobs and things like that. And then we use on to find the contact information. There's a couple of softwares that we work with to make sure that we can get the contact information.
Yeah.
That's pretty hard. You know, the great thing about LinkedIn is you can engage with them, you know their job title, but they don't always respond and there's no phone number.
Yeah.
And, you know, I was actually talking to VP of sales yesterday and, you know, the phone is making a comeback.
Yeah.
Because everybody's just mail merging nonstop and
right.
just emails do not work as well as they worked 5 years ago.
Right.
And now people are not expecting phone calls. So you just pick up the phone and call somebody. It's very likely that you will get to them if you try really hard.
Right.
And so that's one thing that I'm pushing my team on is make sure that, you know, they're using the phone, LinkedIn and emails and obviously, you know, Cadence helps when you don't have a relationship with that account.
Right.
And then we do also with texting.
That's awesome. You've been at this for a while now. And so I would definitely like to know and hear what your feedback is just in terms of how sales has changed since you started to what you guys are doing now. Because obviously things have gotten a lot more complex because of all these different tools that are part of people's tech stacks.
Yeah.
There's a lot more sort of intermingling amongst teams in terms of being able to work together as a team, building that relationship internally within a company, and essentially being a lot more than just a sales team. It's almost like a relationship team where you have CS, you have marketing, you have sales kind of all pitching in to help close a deal. So since you've been at this for a while, I'm curious about your take on how that has evolved from, you know, essentially one guy on the sales team carrying the process all on his own versus the way that it is now where it's a lot more collaborative.
Yeah. Your question made me have a flashback. I used to work at a company called Paychex, and we had a database that was called ACT, and it you had to do all the updating yourself, and I had a Palm Pilot, because this is before smartphones. So, you know, and we're still doing contracts on like, you know, fax machines. And so you just made me remember of a Palm Pilot, which is one of the first pieces of technology that I was using.
I have someone on my team who is not using a smartphone right now. He has a, I'm not going to call him out, but he has a, one of those candy bar phones. It actually has tactile pads on it. So it's funny that you bring up Palm Pilots because to an extent, they still exist in some form today.
Yeah. Well, I think there's a comeback. There's a company called Dumbphone, which basically just gives you a phone where you can just make phone calls and that's it. It'll be interesting to see what happens. But I love technology, and our VP of Customer Success made some comment last week. He's like, I really want to find out what kind, you know, all the toys that your kids have, because like the amount of toys you're buying for your sales rep is a lot. So, but it works if it's used properly. So one of the things that we do on the technology side is we usually release it. I have a lot of reps come to me with ideas and I'm like, well, you try it out, right? And if it works, and then it just grows organically.
Right.
So it's not me coming in and saying, hey guys, I think you should use this.
Yeah.
It's all the reps now are like very creative. And you know, we basically what we do is we work with tech companies and help them with, you know, gather reviews on G2 Crowd. So we know a lot about companies and their reviews and who's doing well. And so we're bombarded by that all the time.
Yeah.
And so now we try to grow it organically and test it out with, you know, use cases.
Right. I know a lot of your products has, they have components that kind of build that synergy between marketing and sales. And, you know, when we've had conversations about some of the content that we want to be able to license, part of the components that you guys are also providing is some of the training that that sales teams would actually be able to benefit from, where marketing would actively push this content out to different prospects, and as part of the 1-2 punch, sales would also know how to speak to these, and you guys provide some of those services. So tell me a little bit more about how that's used internally, and I mean, I know with us, we're definitely trying to take that approach where it's kind of a 360 approach to the way that we're leveraging some of this content to build these relationships with our prospects. But how's that synergy between your sales and marketing teams, and how are they leveraging some of the tools that you guys have access to that are actually part of your product?
Yeah, so we have a great new CMO, Ryan Benici, came over from HubSpot. So he was at HubSpot for a couple of years running inbound marketing, so they're very good there. So we're kind of getting started, but the relationship is excellent. And one of, you know, things is, I think it's important for marketing and sales to be, you know, aligned, and then also to have some of the same metrics, right? So how you're measuring, you know, sales is similar to how you're measuring marketing, so that both teams are not competing with each other. Because I've been, you know, selling to marketing for years, and you know, I've been part of a sales process,
yeah,
where head of marketing, head of sales, they just hate each other,
yeah,
and then you're trying to sell the deal to them and they just don't want to talk to each
other.
They
don't have a relationship.
Yeah, I know, and so it's really hard. I mean, at last startup, it happened all the time because we were selling like a predictive software and I wanted marketing to pay for it, and yeah, the salesperson is like, I want this, and then it's interesting. So I think it's crucial that, you know, the head of sales and head of marketing is aligned. And in terms of content, you know, one thing that we do for our customers is we create content,
yeah,
right? Because there's, you know, you're leveraging the customer voice to, you know, to be able to explain the benefits of your solutions,
right,
to, you know, to the marketplace. And so on our end, it's a little bit different because we have to educate buyers about what we do and the benefits of G2 Crowd. And a lot of people are still not aware of the marketing solutions that we have.
Yeah.
They're aware like, oh, I love G2 Crowd, I use it all the time. Oh, you guys have B2B offerings?
Yeah.
I had no idea. And so we're making headway there. I'm pretty excited to see what's going to come out of the next 6 months.
Yeah, that's awesome. We're definitely excited about some of the things that you guys are putting out there. I feel like I learned about something new once a quarter that we haven't really taken advantage of. That I think at one point we were setting up some programs around sending out gift cards to mm-hmm, thank folks for giving us positive reviews and that sort of thing. And we didn't even realize that that was part of the existing account that we had. So
right,
yeah,
that's how we started. We started as a review site, but now we're really a data company,
yeah,
right? Because we have all this product information. There's around 11 million data points that we have on software from any kind of software you can think of. We also do B2B services as well, and then we're also tracking, you know, the behavior of buyers,
yeah,
which is just kind of cool, right? So we know which companies is researching what software and what, you know, what they're looking at, what they're evaluating. So there's a lot of new things that we're able to help our customers with. And the great thing is our engineering team is amazing.
Yeah.
You know, I get a lot of product feedback all the time, meeting with, you know, individuals like yourself,
right,
bring it back to the product team and like, all right, I think we can do it. And so I'm very fortunate to work at a company, yeah, that's, you know, moves really quickly.
Right, right. That's definitely exciting. Just in terms of the context of sales and the different processes that are in place today, and everyone is essentially a relationship maker on the sales, mm-hmm, team, right? They're reaching out, they're ensuring that they're top of mind with both their product as well as just really trying to understand what some of the needs of their prospects are. And obviously that may or may not have some challenges. And obviously having someone like you in place to be able to help to train and to ensure that some of these challenges are a lot easier to overcome, or at least that there's solutions for them. What is your approach in trying to figure out what these challenges are, kind of identifying them and helping your teams to solve for them?
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day is, you know, I mentioned this earlier, right? Be a human and then have a relation, like have a conversation, like you and I are having.
Yeah.
How are you measuring? Is always one of the questions I make sure all my reps ask is like, how are you measured?
Yeah.
And you know, what are your initiatives? Where are you spending your money? What's working? What's not working? And then once you have that information, then you can figure out if you're the salesperson, like, does it make sense for me to push on that account?
Yeah.
Right? Because if like they don't have any issues and your solution is not addressing any of their issues, like, you know, if you want to build a good relationship and have a good name in the marketplace, you should not try to push your product onto,
yeah,
them and like, hey, you know what? You probably don't need this.
Yeah.
And then the person on the other end is like, what? This never happens. But I've done it a few times
because,
yeah, there was just no fit. And people were like, they really respect that.
Yeah.
And they remember you. And so it's all about relationships. Now that we're all online, you know, you got LinkedIn and you have, you know, social media and all that. You have to be really careful,
yeah,
about how you treat people. And, you know, if you do a good job, that's great. But if you do a bad job, you're going to hear about it,
yeah,
for a very long time.
Yeah.
So.
And your product is one of those channels where people can make their voice heard.
Yes.
And definitely,
yeah,
know, and just in terms of what they think of a given product or a given process, right?
For sure.
Yeah.
And one of the questions you had asked me, which I want to make sure we talk about, is, you know, you mentioned reviews, right? And the answer is like, oh, I'm concerned about having too many reviews and not enough reviews. How do I get good reviews? And I just want to let everybody know it's not about getting just good reviews. It's a volume game, and if you only have, you know, 20 reviews that are all 5-star, if I'm a buyer, I don't believe it.
Yeah.
Right? I'm gonna know, like, you only ask your top customers for these reviews. So it's a volume game. There is no perfect software product, right? And that's why we're, you know, all these tech companies are releasing, and I don't know how quickly you guys do it, but we release on a weekly basis.
Yeah.
So we're always making, you know, improvements to our product. And so that's one thing. It's just a volumes game.
Yeah.
That's my advice for you guys today is, you know, if you have a software product and you want to get it on a G2 crowd, it's free. But two is like, just get as many reviews as possible, because I always look at, you know, the worst reviews to see like what's the worst possible outcome. And in some cases, like, it's just somebody. It's not, you know, wasn't happy with for a couple of reasons, but, you know.
Right.
Not everybody's going to be happy.
Right. That's great. Obviously, with G2 Crowd being a platform where folks can research, I would definitely want to know where you look for, you know, sort of either validation or where you look for tips on how to best operate your team and to really understand.
Oh, right.
You know, what are some of the things that are working now that you might want to implement and to improve some of the processes that you have in place?
Yeah, I mean, so there's a lot of places online that I look for content, and we can talk about that in a second. But I think one of the most important skill sets to have is storytelling.
Yeah.
Right? One is customer stories, right? Where, you know, this was the issue of my customer, and they weren't able to overcome, and then we helped them do this, and now they're here today, right? People love stories.
Yeah.
And so that's like probably the most important thing that I try to teach my reps that are struggling to do a good job is, you know, is sometimes they just have a hard time establishing a connection in the beginning, right? The rapport and so on.
Right.
And then two is they're not able to leverage the customer stories effectively at the right time.
Yeah, yeah. Well, tell us a little bit more about that, just in terms of timing and really understanding when is the right time to introduce certain things or when is the right time to pull certain levers to ensure that the prospects that you're building these relationships with, that you guys are moving in lockstep and really having a good understanding of what each other's needs are and understanding what the right timing is for something. Like you were mentioning earlier that you have outright told prospects that, you know, maybe the product's not a good fit or and being really transparent with them about that stuff. But at what point do you know when to pull certain levers? And I would imagine you tap into your experience quite a bit to really know when to do that.
I mean, I think it depends, right? Every call is going to be a little bit different. It depends if you have the decision makers as well on your first call, right? Mm-hmm. Sometimes you don't. Sometimes we, you know, a lot of selling from below and above, right? You know, and so what you don't want to do is not give Dyvault too much information on the first call, especially if it's a lower level person that's probably not, doesn't hold the budget.
Yeah.
So what we try to do is, you know, understand, get a few questions, discovery, build some rapport, and then show them the potential using G2 Crowd. But it can be overwhelming because there's a lot of things that we do that most people aren't aware of. So just giving enough information to get, you know, the prospect to understand, like, I see value in this.
Yeah.
And then you're like, okay, great, would you, and then they might ask for pricing, like, sorry, we're not there yet.
Yeah.
And so, but if you see value, I'd love to have a, you know, a second conversation. I have some questions I want to ask you. I'd also like for you to involve a couple of other stakeholders that are probably going to be involved in this decision.
Right.
And then, but just, you know, give them value every time you do outreach. The other thing is, you know, if you have a couple of good meetings, but something happens, they don't get back. What I tell my reps is like, email them with value and not ask anything.
Yeah.
And then they're just, the prospect's like, whoa, I got a great email.
Yeah.
Say like, I thought of you, here's a great article, or congratulations, or whatever happened, but not ask anything.
Right.
And then like the third time, you're like, hey, by the way, you know, wanted to resurface this. You mentioned this and this.
Yeah.
I'd love to chat more about it. I really feel that we can help you. Here's a case study.
Yeah.
And here is a connection to somebody that I know that you know that is currently a customer. But you can't just always be asking for something as a sales rep, because that's, you can't build a good relationship if you're always the one asking for something.
Right. What you just mentioned was actually, I feel like it's pretty unique just in terms of making that connection or at least helping a prospect to network with other folks who are in similar situations and helping them to build relationships with other people. But when did you guys start introducing that as part of your process?
I don't know. I mean, we do events. We try to do like networking events at G2. I was just telling you we took 15 marketing and sales executives to see the Warriors second game of the playoffs, and so it was a great networking opportunity. We have current customers, we have prospects, they're all mingling.
Yeah.
So they're building the network, and then, you know, hopefully the customers are saying nice things to our prospect, and so it works out. But I mean, this is, you know, we're in San Francisco. It's a pretty small town. Once you've been doing this for a while, you get to know everybody.
Right.
So you want to make sure that people think of you as like somebody that, you know, can make things happen, and two, somebody that's always, you know, looking out for the other person. It's not always asking for something.
Right.
Because salespeople do get like a bad bad rap. You know, it happens because there's some people that just ask.
I love salespeople. Well, before we wrap up, obviously I wanted to thank you so much for being able to join us today and to provide us with this insight as well as our audience. But is there anything else that you wanted to say that could possibly help out some of these folks who are trying to learn a little bit more about how to improve a lot of their processes?
Yeah, I mean, we talked about it, being curious. So, every morning, when I start my day, I'll start reading some content. LinkedIn's a good place. If you're a salesperson, you're listening to this, I like what Sales Hacker is doing. Gainsight has a really good content as well. So I think, continuously educating yourself every single day and learning something new, I think is important. And then the last thing is to get outside your comfort zone. I learned this early in my career. I read a really good book, which I forget. I was trying to be a stockbroker. But anyways, one of the things in the book, that didn't work out. One of the things in the book was, get outside of your comfort zone every single day, right? So make that dial, right, that you don't want to do to this, unhappy customer.
Yeah.
Or, do one thing extra every day that, makes you outside your comfort zone. And guess what? Like, pretty soon, it's really hard to get outside your comfort zone. So for any young people out there, that's my advice.
Awesome. Well, thanks again for joining us today. And to those folks out in the internet who are watching us, we would like to thank you again for spending some time with us. And hopefully you're able to take away some useful insights that will really help you out in terms of building these relationships with your clients, your prospects, and hopefully your customers. Be sure to check out our blog and take a look at some of the additional links as well as some of the other content that we have there. There's lots of good stuff that hopefully will help you in building out these relationships.